There is nothing wrong with your television set. Do not attempt to adjust the picture. We are controlling transmission. We will control the horizontal. We will control the vertical. We can change the focus to a soft blur or sharpen it to crystal clarity. For the next hour, sit quietly and we will control all that you see and hear. You are about to participate in a great adventure. You are about to experience the awe and mystery which reaches from the inner mind to...
Welcome to What a Week, KSQD's Listener's Digest of all the news from this last week that you really need to know. I'm Tony Russomanno.
And I'm Erik Nelson, and have we got a show for you.
Now, you can't be well-informed unless you are informed well. And that's where What a Week comes in.
For the next hour, we're going to dive deep into what's been going on over the last 7 days, giving you a quick rundown of what's happening here in Santa Cruz and in the rest of the world.
And because sometimes you just want to get away from it all, we'll play you some music designed to soothe your soul and bring a smile to your face.
So turn up that radio, fire up that internet browser, and get ready for another edition of KSQD's What a Week.
So where were we before we were so rudely interrupted?
Well, I'll tell you where I was. I was sitting under a surgeon's knife getting a new knee.
Oh, excellent. And how is Robo-Knee treating you these days?
Yes, well, I really am Robo-Tony now. And recovery was amazing. Folks, I want to tell you something. The Joint Replacement Center at Good Sam Hospital in Los Gatos, there's a big sign on the hospital now. It says Joint Replacement Center. It's an entire floor. It's not marketing. Everybody who works there is trained specifically in joint replacement. Boy, it is not the hospital of 30 or 40 years ago where you had to wait 6 hours for a doctor to approve some painkiller. They got everything they need on the floor, and they're ready to go. Fabulous job. I was there overnight.
Clearly, those painkillers are still working, Tony. So,
if they're free, it's for me.
Yeah, it's free, it's for me. So where to begin? You know, the shocking thing about a show that recaps everything on a weekly basis, when you take a month on, the earth cools considerably. I mean, you can't imagine all the phantom What a Weeks we could have been doing and all the stories that we could have been discussing, but we're not going to do What a Month. In fact, we're going to focus pretty much on the last few days, because you could do 3 or 4 hours on the events of the next last few days. But let's start, as we often do, with local news. And, well, the big headline for us and for everyone in Santa Cruz is the fact that Lookout Santa Cruz, our beloved plucky online paper of record, won a Pulitzer Prize, which is astonishing, not because it isn't deserved, but astonishing that, well, a plucky local digital news network in Santa Cruz would beat all the big guys
and
win.
A tiny, plucky local
tiny
news
and mighty,
outlet.
And they
the word tiny appeared repeatedly in the headlines across the country.
You could just see our favorite beloved New York Times and Washington Post all scratching their heads saying, what? Who? They did what?
No. These things happen.
Well, the thing to do if you want to see why it was so well-deserved is go to Lookout and kind of dive deep in there. They actually have a copy of the application that you have to enter. You have to fill out something and submit your work.
Yeah,
and
you don't get it if you don't ask.
They submitted this incredible digest of all the reporting they did. And when you see how comprehensive their reporting of the atmospheric rivers, the catastrophic atmospheric rivers, just how much the six key writers were managed to cover 24/7.
The entire staff was awarded the Pulitzer, and the Pulitzer Commission, the committee said in its award, for its detailed and nimble community-focused coverage over a holiday weekend of catastrophic flooding and mudslides that displaced thousands of residents and destroyed more than 1,000 homes and businesses, the staff of Lookout Santa Cruz, California, of Tiny Lookout Santa Cruz, California, is
Plucky.
Awarded the Pulitzer Prize for breaking news reporting. With it comes a cash prize of $15,000, cash American dollars. Right. And look, A little bit of history on the Pulitzer. This is not the first local news organization to win a Pulitzer Prize. The Register Pajaronian, the Watsonville Register Pajaronian, won a Pulitzer in 1956 for a story that resulted in a corrupt district attorney getting booted out of office. I think he was also thrown in jail. And Santa Cruz's own Martha Mendoza. Martha Mendoza has won two Pulitzer Prizes working for the Associated Press. Martha used to work for the Sentinel, and she won her first in 2000 for investigative reporting. She won her second in 2023. She won her second in 2016 for more investigative reporting. That's what she's been doing. And she's gone from the Sentinel to the Associated Press and multiple Pulitzer, which is something I am sure we will soon be saying about the staff of Tiny Lookout Santa Cruz. And Tiny Lookout is now its official name.
Well, no. Congratulations, though, to our colleagues. I'd like to say colleagues, but they're actually doing a quality investigative
and actual
good news,
journalism,
unlike what
right.
a week.
Yeah,
they are
wearing out the shoe leather, pounding the
pavement. Doing the work rather than talking about others who are doing the work and making snarky comments.
Well, at least we give credit when we steal others, you know, when we steal their work, we give them lots of credit and kudos and all that stuff.
We prefer to say homage to their work,
homage,
whatever. So other story we've been covering, we brought this up before we went down, and now there's an update. Is this the 18-story building that they proposed near the clock tower, Tony, or was this another story that got another building that got shot down?
I think that's a Trojan horse. I think it's a red herring. You know, the developer comes in with plans for an 18-story building. Everybody loses their stuff, you know. And then on the same day everybody's losing their stuff, the developer puts in an alternate plan for a smaller building, you know, 6-7 story, something like that, thinking, I suppose, this is what the comments have been in the letters to the editor and the Sentinel and elsewhere, it's just a distraction. They say 18 stories and they come back with something a lot less, and people are then supposed to think, oh, well, it's only, you know, X a lot less, therefore it's a whole lot better.
Well, they knocked out the food bin, the 5-story building that replaces the food bin. Didn't that just go down?
No, that's still there. No, did they knock it down?
No,
they're going to knock it down.
The city delays approval of the 5-story building to replace food bin, correct? It tells developer
yes,
to get
right.
real. That's the story.
Oh, you were talking about the
story. I know. I'm moving on to the food bin
okay.
story, Tony.
You were talking about the clock tower.
Yeah, now we're moving
now you're
on
talking
to
about
food
the food bin.
Yes.
The city council has delayed a vote on the food bin. You said knock it down, though. No, they haven't knocked it down. They delayed the vote, and as things happen in Santa Cruz, it's been put off for a while. The new owner of that building wants to keep the food bin and keep the vegetable store, but have it in the new building. So
and that's the one on Mission Street,
that.
Correct?
That's correct, yeah.
Now, keep an eye on that. Though when I was driving trying to drive through the one-way morass of streets by Natural Bridges and the Lighthouse, went up to the Circle, and, well, where that Circle Church used to be is now rubble. So
it is
that,
deceased.
In fact, was no, knocked down.
That
correct?
Was.
That's gone.
That was one of the ones that went. And, yeah.
And they don't have is there something planned to go there, or
housing?
They just knocked it down?
Housing is the plan, you know.
But has anything been approved? Is anything going to start construction?
It's in progress. They got the approval to knock it down, which means that, you know, they're on track to put something else in there, which is, you know, not a park, which I'm sure a lot of people would like to see. But housing is up there in the needs and wants of a lot of people in town also.
And I noticed the giant tree that used to be at that key juncture, the gateway to Walnut Street, not only is the tree gone, there's no sign it ever existed. You can see the sidewalk. They put the sidewalk right in. So now you see a perfectly preserved mid-50s apartment building.
Now, see,
there.
If they really were serious about housing, they would keep the tree and use it for a treehouse.
Yeah,
but
well,
no,
there's that.
No, they knocked
anyway,
the tree
that
down.
Tree's gone, so
gone.
More
yeah.
progress. But some good news now, another story we're following up on, where AT&T was saying, we don't need to provide those stupid landline phone services. Why, you know, our other system works so well.
Yeah,
he said,
two
looking
words.
Up at the sunspots.
Two words, earthquake.
Yeah, exactly. So I understand, Tony, what has there been a change in the weather for landlines?
Yes, the weather is looking sunny for landlines. California Public Utilities Commission started looking at it, and they put out a rather nasty a nastily worded report on their meeting, which clearly signals that they are going to disallow the Pac Bell request to stop the AT&T request. I'm sorry, to stop landline service and transfer the responsibility for last available landline service to some other company, which would then promptly ignore any upgrades or any service on it. So it looks like it is headed for survival for the instrument that is useful to help us survive during catastrophes, which is a plain old telephone line, POTS, plain old telephone service, otherwise known as the Twin Copper Landline.
And in a story we're going to be beating to death all year because it's an absolutely crucial anniversary for us in Santa Cruz. Giant Dipper, birthday party for the Giant Dipper next Saturday night. We'll be all over this next Saturday, too. Fireworks, actually fireworks down there? I thought they weren't supposed to fire fireworks off down there.
It's a special occasion. And not only are
but
they
But if a firework happens to land on the creosote-soaked Giant Dipper, that would be perfect.
Tut, tut, tut. One worries too much. Now, look, here, I have something to assuage your worry, your paranoia. Not only are they having fireworks next Saturday night, but Discretion Brewery will release a Giant Dipper Golden Ale 100th Anniversary Special Centennial can of beer. And that will be available starting later on this week. I think they trotted out Friday. It will be released next Saturday in a 19.2-ounce can and draft at the Boardwalk and at Discretion Brewery. A very nice-looking can, too. There's a nice picture of it.
So
in, by the way, look
what
at
what could
Santa
possibly
Cruz.
Go wrong? Giant cans of high IP, high
High explosives alcohol. And alcohol.
Yeah, high That's, explosive, yeah. custom-made alcohol in
no
the creosote-soaked Giant Dipper.
This Fire it up, Jack.
Santa Cruz. ladies and gentlemen. Well, we'll take a little musical break. A lot of music has come out. We always like on What a Week to recap interesting music that's just come out. And T-Bone Burnett has come out with a terrific record. T-Bone Burnett, the producer of Oh Brother, Where Out Thou soundtrack and all sorts of great records. Elvis Costello's King of America, member of the Rolling Thunder Review with Bob Dylan, and a solo record. So this is a real interesting song. It's called The Other Side. It just came out, and listen for yourself.
Get over it now. I'm gonna get over this some way or at the moment. I don't know how. I don't want to be the judge, and I don't want to hold a grudge. I'm gonna get over this someday. I might as well get over it now. I don't want to compete with you. The whole night.
gonna get over this someday. I might as well get over it now. I might as well get over it now. I might as well get over it now.
Gonna Get Over It Someday, T-Bone Burnett, album The Other Side. You're listening to What a Week with Erik Nelson.
And a fatalistic Tony Russomanno.
Fatalistic Tony Russomanno.
Yeah, well, it's a fatalistic song we just had.
Oh, I see. Yes. Yeah. And
you see how I bring that in, a kind of segue,
yeah,
and bridge the gap here.
Yeah, for a split second, I thought we were listening to an actual professional radio show. Go figure. So, we have Robo Tony in person, in the flesh,
yeah,
or in the titanium, or whatever the hell is in your knee right now. And then we also have Robo Tony to introduce our next segment featuring, well, one of our favorite whipping boys here, the great Elon Musk, member of Thrush. And what does Thrush stand for?
Thrush, the technological hierarchy for the removal of undesirables and the subjugation of humanity.
Stuff some cotton in that Robo Tony. He's got that awful echo still.
Yeah, boy, did that overmodulation start throbbing in your knee? I'm just kind of curious. So, yes, Elon is back. Mother Jones did an interesting piece on him. I'll talk about that in just a second. But I heard a great description of the Cybertruck. I've been calling it bad sort of Lego-like strange product. Somebody said it looks like something that was designed for a low-budget 1970s science fiction movie set in, 2020, which
true.
Is about right.
Yeah.
You know, with the slab sides, it looks like they put plywood on the side, sprayed it silver, kind of did what they did to the Batmobile, except really badly.
Some leggy platinum blonde will, slip out of the passenger side,
Yeah, and it's fun because you can see them in the wild occasionally, and there was one that I saw that was actually festooned with Trump stickers. It was the perfect storm of
I believe that's a factory option.
But when you see them in the wild, you do definitely. The great thing, though, is when you see them, you either break up laughter, a giant WTF ? Comical lines. I mean, it's not exactly the thing they want. Or also, you're looking very closely to see, as you know, the accelerators were jamming on a few of them. They had to recall the fleet because the accelerators would jam and you couldn't take it off unless you did a very complicated series of foot maneuvers.
I can't condemn an entire program for one minor failure.
One slip up. But anyway, Mother Jones did a, this is not a project that I pity the poor reporter. This reporter read everything that Musk had to say on X, which used to be Twitter, and tracked everyone he interacted with.
Just for a week. Just for a week.
Musk tweeted 389 times in 5 days, and he posted a laughing, crying emoji 45 times. But the clear signal they got is that basically he's not a tech visionary, nor is he just a bored billionaire. He basically believes his work, he was put on Earth as part of a civilizational struggle in which woke progressives pose an existential threat to humanity. Now, I like that. I mean, I like to think that What a Week, we pose an existential threat to humanity. What do you think, Tony?
You pose an existential threat to me every week.
Well, I do my best. But some of the if you start reading the quotes, once you see the true battle is expansionist versus extinctionist, Musk writes, you can't unsee it.
And, he's got 11 kids, so he even talked about what it's like to be a parent.
He said, whoa, I just realized that raising a kid is basically 18 years of prompt engineering.
He also said,
he quipped.
Yeah, he also said, our first somebody else wrote in and asked and said, our first child will be born next month and asked, what's your biggest piece of advice?
This is
a former Tesla employee.
Now,
asked
that's it.
In response
and
to
think
Musk.
About that feature. I want to do that. Ask Elon, where you write Elon Musk for advice. So the question, what's your biggest piece of advice for my first child? And this is it. He had a softball over the plate. He could actually be a normal human being.
Musk said.
And what was his response, Tony?
Be super careful about what schools teach your kids.
Yes, and as Mother Jones concludes, at least Howard Hughes kept out of sight.
Mm-hmm.
And not unrelated news, I forgot where this article was, is smart cars. I drive a fleet, one 25-year-old car, another 19-year-old car, and the newest car is, 12 years old. before they started putting all those new fancy schmancy screens. I sound like Grandpa Simpson here, but I don't want cars with screens. I like cars with knobs and switches, not necessarily a crank on the windshield, you know, on the roll down the window.
Did you ever own a Volkswagen?
Yeah,
you
I did.
As a matter of fact,
multiple Volkswagens.
That's right. Yes, yeah, they're wonderful cars. Three moving parts.
But basically, the smart car you're getting, wait for it, is gathering information all the time from you. Sex life data, biometric data, demographic, race, sexual orientation, gender, everything.
Wait a minute.
Yeah.
Sexual orientation?
The
they
cars,
get that information from driving a car?
The cars and the fear of this and is that car companies can share your info with law enforcement without your knowledge. A domestic abuser could use it to track your whereabouts. It doesn't take a lot of imagination to see where this is going. Last year, U.S. Senator Ed Markey reached out to the car companies to say, guys, why are you harvesting this data and where is the data going? And he's not getting prompt responses on this. And the article goes on to say someone had a brand new Honda and they wanted just to turn the data gathering off. And let's just say the phrase Kafka-esque experience goes, where it's impossible to stop the cars. You know, it's fairly well. It's complicated enough in your iPhone or Android phone to switch it off. They had to make it a little easier, but your car, not the other thing. So if you got a brand new car, maybe at the dealer before you drive it off the lot, you say, "Hey, I want to stand there and I want you to shut it all off."
Let's, you know, it must be on the credit application that they get all that information. I'm checking how can driving a car give all that data on personal information?
You know,
it has to be in the paperwork hidden somewhere that you
or
fill
the
out.
It's part of your data profile, and it all goes in. I know this sounds like ooh, big tech. How can they do this? Needlessly activating people's paranoia, but check it out, folks, on new cars. Well, good news in technology. Tony, you're a fan of Star Trek, the first movie, Star Trek, you know, the one with the very first one, the Robert Wise film.
Yes.
V'ger is still V'ger. Up and running. So, you know, the events.
One and two, but
the V'gers are still running, and they're both running, but V'ger 1 had stopped. I just want to say, is this a coincidence or not, Tony? So, yesterday, for the first time since 2003, an extreme geomagnetic storm, basically auroras everywhere. I saw a picture off Golden Gate Bridge. I don't think we saw it down here, but perhaps we did. But certainly everywhere up north looked amazing. And in the same period of those auroras and sunspots, V'ger gets turned back on. Coincidence or conspiracy?
Oh, yeah. Wow.
Because V'ger 1 now is 15 billion miles away. It went down. And they're using, speaking of the technology that designed the Cybertruck, early 70s science fiction technology, that's what's powering V'ger. So you're our correspondent
watch,
here.
My watch has more electronics in it than Voyager 1 does.
But V'ger how do they 1. Fire that thing up?
It took a brilliant core of scientists to figure it out. They unplugged it and then plugged it back in again.
That's pretty much it. And then they used the precision adjustment tool, a.k.a. the hammer on the hammer, original flight council.
Rebooted Windows 95.
Anyway, it's working, folks, and that's great news, and we'll leave it at that. Well, speaking of a 70s throwbacks and 70s nostalgia, because we like to report on many things on What a Week, including Broadway and the Tony Awards.
Oh, boy.
The Stereophonic got more nominations than anything ever in the history of the Tonys.
Stereophonic.
Stereophonic is a musical about the creation of, wait for it, Rumours by Fleetwood Mac.
Oh.
It's not about that, but pretty much it's that. Oh. The Rumours session where Stevie Nicks and Lindsey Buckingham had just broken up and were writing songs about each other, and John McVie had broken up from Christine McVie, and blah, blah, blah. All the Sturm und Drang and soap opera inspired this Broadway musical, which has just cleaned house. The music was written by Will Butler from Arcade Fire, and they just, wait for it, last week came out with the soundtrack. So again, if you're sitting down and you want to do a song, you want to do Rumours, 77, let's be precise, 77 Fleetwood Mac. This is the song that they did. So this is the big song that you hear throughout, and it's the making of this song that's the thread of the whole thing. So if you're a fan of Fleetwood Mac, which I have to say I am, and Stevie Nicks, because who isn't, check out this song. Just came out last week. Multiple Tony nominee Stereophonic. Thank you.
grab my bag and I'm on my way. The old man told me that I shouldn't go. There are things I couldn't know.
Said you may be wise, but you haven't seen her eyes. So
he shook his head and I hit the road. Forget your eyes. Shadows reaching out for my heart. And I keep moving on through the dark.
Travel many miles and I love to stop a while, but
nothing shall gonna keep us apart. Forget your eyes. Promises I made were made of glass. Gathered all the shards to bring to you. I lit a candle and I prayed for 40 nights. I haven't heard an answer yet. I like the silence anyway.
Fleetwood, not Mac. That's Masquerade, Tony nominated. You know, they got the riff, they got the harmonies. They don't get the twirling with scarves.
This is a brand new musical on Broadway now.
So to say, interesting topic, as they would say. Speaking of interesting topics, another one I like to do on What a Week. This would be What a Week on KSQD Santa Cruz, KSQT Prunedale. I would be Erik Nelson.
And I'm Tony Russomanno.
And yes, it's time for our Chud of the Week. Now, what is a Chud, you might ask?
Chud, cannibalistic, humanoid, underground dwellers.
And it's pretty tough. Our Chud of the Week should be very obvious to just about everybody, and that would be a vice presidential former wannabe. And the person, somebody figured out, what could a Republican finally do to actually alienate the Republicans? Is there anything a Republican could possibly do? What bar could they limbo under?
I have a feeling you're about to tell us.
Yes, and that would be, of course, Kristi Noem, a.k.a. the puppy
Kristi
killer.
Kristi Noem, come on down, Kristi.
With the worst book tour since O.J. Simpson's.
She's pulled off the book tour.
The worst book tour since the OJ's If I Did It book, if you remember that tour. So we won't even go to the recap. And if you're living in deep in a underground bunker with a fellow chuds or in a missile silo, have no access to
ignorance
anything.
Is bliss in this case.
Basically, she did a biography with blames her ghostwriter, of course, for trumpeting the fact that she had a dog named Cricket. And Cricket.
A puppy named Cricket.
A 14-month-old puppy that was misbehaving and eating chickens. And she hated, quote, that dog, and she took it out to the gravel pit and shot it. And then there was a goat she also had an issue
shoot
with.
Shoot that for good
so
measure,
shot the
too.
Goat.
What
yeah,
the
she,
heck, yeah.
She, in the words of,
they were conspiring.
In the words of Johnny Cash, she shot the goat just to watch him die.
Yeah.
So let's just go to the real source of American journalism and the pulse beat of America. And that would, of course, be the reviews on Amazon of her book. So this is Amazon Book Review Theater here. These are some of the reviews her book is getting. Tony, you go first.
After listening to the Audible sample, I will not purchase. The narrator has a very irritating voice. Must have been listening to What a Week.
Well, she got off light there.
Oh, yeah.
I like this one. A book actually better used to start fires. Mm-hmm.
Considering that this book is bound to go back to the publisher for revisions, I don't see where it would be something I'd want to add to my collection anytime soon. The excerpt was tedious and filled with political tropes. And not to mention, she shot the dog.
Yeah, don't forget that part. People who start off murdering innocent animals oftentimes end up being serial killers or vice presidential runmates to Trump. I guess Christie decided just to murder her career in politics instead. Terribly written, terribly voiced. And I won't get into all that lying she did. George Santos in drag.
Wait a minute. Christie definitely showed how strong of a leader she is by killing an evil, defiant puppy and a horrible goat. God help us all. But why stop there? She could be demonstrating her toughness by stomping on communist kittens and deporting illegal migrant Canada geese straight to hell.
And last but certainly not least, the dog should have grabbed the gun and popped a cap in
her. Well, that's one man's opinion.
Yeah,
anyway.
One man's opinion. And Paul Rudnick, who's, let's just say, always likes to weigh in on pressing issues. Some other shocking claims from Christie Noem's book, Tony?
Yeah. Some of my hair is real.
I read this book.
Yeah, indeed. I shot and ate Bambi's mom.
I arm wrestled a chair.
My kids call me Dad's wife.
Kim Jong-un told me I'm smarter than Carrie Lake.
I dated Stalin until I found out he was a commie.
Okay. And speaking of Republican inheritance, Christy Britt, remember the all-time classic State of the Union response
in
the weird robotic, that Stepford mom with a cross around her neck, et cetera, et cetera. Saturday Night Live, she was memorably portrayed by Scarlett Johansson in the speaking of softballs. So she's back, and this is, if I can get this thing to play, this is her message to the American people. I think this came out yesterday. Let's listen in to Katie Britt. What pearls of wisdom does she have? This time, she's standing in a set. You can see the Capitol Dome in the background, but she has the cross around her neck, and she has that big, perky smile.
Hi. As a mom, I know that there is no greater blessing in this life than our children. And I also understand the types of challenges that women face during their pregnancy journeys and while raising their kids. This week, I'm introducing the Moms Act in the Senate. The Moms Act stands for More Opportunities for Moms to Succeed. This legislation would provide critical support to women during typically challenging phases of motherhood. That includes the prenatal, postpartum, and early childhood development stages. To all of my fellow moms out there, my goal is to give you and your children the opportunities to thrive and to live your American dreams. I'll continue to fight to advance a comprehensive culture of life, to empower parents, and to grow opportunities for hard-working families so that every child across our nation can reach their God-given potential and every woman can thrive.
Oh, that's sweet. Just here, important safety tip, just don't get raped in any of the southern states.
Yes, and Katie Britt, though, didn't mention in the ad that she wants to create a, quote, national registry of pregnant women to, quote, help expectant moms. So you can register in and get your date book in.
And make sure you don't get an abortion in any of the southern states.
Yes, and Paul Rudnick has some quotes about this. If you're a part of this National Registry of Pregnant Women to help expectant moms also, to arrest and jail them if they seek abortions, to herd them into camps.
That's right. To pit them against each other in a Hunger Games arena.
And to force them to say, Heil Katie. So, yes, Katie, rough. Yeah, well, rough, but Katie, yeah, what can you say? Oh, and other news here. Oh, it's so such a thrill to be back on the radio, so I have an excuse to play
for
this again.
Yeah, he, this court is now in session. His Honor, Judge Pigmeat Marked and Poseidon. Yeah, he, the coat of swing is just about ready to do that thing. I don't want no tears, I don't want no lies. Above all, I don't want no alibis. This judge is hip, and that ain't all. He'll give you time if you're big or small. Fall in line, or this coat is neat. Peace, brother.
Here come the judges, actually, in this case. Where do we begin here?
Well, let's start with our favorite judge, Clarence Thomas. This is breaking news. He's pushed back on his critics because they've been saying mean things about
him.
Speaking of Pulitzer Prizes, ProPublica got a Pulitzer Prize for the reporting on Thomas's various malfeasances, the fact that he's bought and paid for by Leonard Leo. Remember the RVs that he was gifted and his young warden protege being getting free schooling, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And he said that he described it as nastiness and lies, and he's called Washington a hideous place. And he refuses to take, you know, John Oliver literally has $1 million check in his desk drawer that Oliver is personally guaranteeing if Thomas will resign. If money's so important, Oliver keeps saying, my wife dreads me the day that Thomas takes me up on my offer, but he's not taking it.
Well,
but,
no, he might. You know, calling Washington a hideous place sounds like he's laying the groundwork for his resignation letter. Dear Mr. President,
but
Washington
might
is a hideous
say that
place.
It sounds like Thomas would really appreciate a Senate judiciary hearing to discuss all of this to set the ratings straight.
That,
come on, Democrats. Imagine Democrats were willing to do for court corruption what Republicans are willing to do for Gaza war protests, Senate hearings, press conferences. This is like, you know, come on down, folks. I think Thomas should be, we should have full, this is no joke, of course.
No.
Let's go. You know, let's talk about this.
I like it when you're helpful like that, Eric. Yeah. You really, you know, restore my faith in the democratic process.
Well, Republicans always understand no matter how serious an issue actually is, making a big show about it gets attention, and they certainly know how to play the media. We'll be talking more about that.
Yeah.
And then Kavanaugh, Judge, I had a brewski with Squee. Remember that guy who got all upset?
He likes beer.
Yeah, he likes beer. He spoke to, I love who he spoke to, a conversation Friday with Judge Priscilla Richmond of the U.S. Court of Appeals for the, drum roll please, the Fifth Circuit. That's where liberal dreams go to die. They're the ones that are constantly putting the worst, they're the ones that the worst rulings that then have to go to the Supreme Court, that even sometimes the Supreme Court kicks out, that are basically rolling the clock back to the Salem witch trials, usually start with the Fifth Circuit. But he met there to say that, you know, to talk about transparency, and he says, I'm an impartial judge. And he's basically saying that, you know, we just need more impartiality in the Supreme Court, Brett Kavanaugh. So we like that. And in other news, well, someone pointed out, it looks like the GOP picks its nominees for the federal bench by heading to a Trump rally and firing judicial robes out of a T-shirt cannon, which I think is an excellent way of putting that.
Good reason to go.
And Tony, remember last couple of weeks we were down, but there was a law passed to limit credit card late fees, that basically stop the ridiculous and...
That's great. Now, that certainly is a bipartisan issue. Everybody's going to get behind that. Who doesn't want to limit credit card late fees?
Well, Eric? How about U.S. District Judge Mark T. Pittman, a nominated by Trump judge in 2019, who basically just put the blocks to that law. He basically stopped it and is sending it back to where it began.
Why? So, why?
Because we're just plain evil, Tony. You have to understand.
It's not like free speech. You know, credit card companies have the right to, charge whatever they want because it's all freedom of speech or something like that.
And are we going to talk about Eileen Cannon, who's basically planning to put the Florida National Archives stolen documents trial, put it on the docket for some time in maybe 2100 by finding every possible loophole to delay things? Again, a Trump-appointed judge. She picked up that judicial robe as shot through the T-shirt cannon. And one thing I love about this, there's only one picture of Cannon. If you've noticed, check out the folks. Yeah. If you look at art, there was a picture, a screen capture from a Zoom call. That is the only photograph anyone seems to have on her. Mm. I'm not even sure this woman exists. How could there be no photographic record whatsoever other than a out-of-focus, her mouth's partway open photograph? I just point this out. It baffles me that so many
findings. I'll tell you why. Because she's hardly heard any trials at all. I mean, what is her experience? She doesn't have any.
But hasn't she like walked through a mall security camera? Or does she own a new Honda, which has probably taken her photograph and uploaded all of her vital statistics to a Honda Central? I mean, I'm just pointing this out. Okay, we're ranting again. And, you know, a regular topic here is, first off, Tony, you got some breaking news about Santa Cruz student pros. Remember we mentioned how we freely read stuff on Lookout and then give it to you? Tony did this on practically in real time.
Right. Lookout Santa Cruz just posted something. It's an update on the student Palestine sit-in, or not sit-in, but encampment at UCSC. According to Lookout, just a couple of minutes ago, the student protesters say negotiations are over. They have ended negotiations to put an end to the encampment. The students say the negotiations have failed because the administrators, and this is a quote, refused to meaningfully concede, end quote, refused to meaningfully concede to protesters' demands, and they're bracing now for police raids. But Lookout also says that some people close to the negotiations say the administrators are looking to avoid calling in the cops right away. And Lookout also had a look at the some of the negotiations, and it shows that the two sides appeared at least at one point to be pretty close to agreeing on a couple of the student demands. So,
well, they should have read the New York Times today, the editorial today. There's a big editorial from the entire editorial board. The reason why campus protest is out of control now is that university leaders did not listen to all of our op-eds about how right-wing speech was being threatened by wokeness. Basically, it's another tisking from the New York Times editorial page about all those liberal university leaders who were cracking down on right-wing freedom of speech, and somehow the New York Times has twisted it around. They've been completely, the New York Times has just been all over this constantly about totally pro-anti-demonstrations. They covered the Columbia thing. Why? Because it's in New York.
In New York, of course. So of course. That was the best day in assignment editor's history. You know, a major news story happening about 10 blocks away from the headquarters. Wow. No travel fees. You know, don't even have to pay for a cab ride. Just tell the correspondent to take a hike up the block.
Well,
man.
And also the reporting is so selective. As someone pointed out, Rush Limbaugh, may he rot in hell, developed a propaganda technique I see in widespread use today. His researchers would scour the media for incidents where liberals and progressives did something absurd and self-contradictory, and those would be the incidents he'd endlessly broadcast.
Of course, that creates the reality.
Right, and that by amplifying the absurd, he sought to discredit the entire progressive left by pointing out the ridiculous outlier examples to taint the entire pool, which is what the New York Times has been doing most of the coverage. I will give the LA Times credit, though, and the New York Times actually did it too. At UCLA, when the God knows who, the right wing goons, frat house goons, attacked the protesters, the encampments, and the police sat on their hands for 3.5 hours while the disruption was happening, while people were getting beaten up, student on student violence. But because the violence was going in the direction that the police approved of and the administration didn't care about it, they let it happen. But the New York Times, I will say, did dissect that, as did the LA Times. But like, really? And it's this, we've been on it, we don't even need to do our, remember New York Times PitchBot, if you're a regular listener of What a Week, we don't even need to do that anymore because the New York Times really does it yourself.
By design, it's their intent to do it that way.
And, you know, Democrats are in there, too. You know, it's if you're a right wing professor saying your speech is violated, the New York Times will make you a celebrity. A right wing student will write an op-ed, and it's happened. No equivalent support for violations of leftist speech. And again, how many diner pieces? We go to Trump country to find out what the voters in Trump land think. Where are the reports live from Staff of Life in Santa Cruz, the People's Republic of Santa Cruz? We talk to ordinary shoppers about what they think of Trump. Well, we don't need to do that. And now the interesting thing is, and Marty Baron, who was the editor of The Washington Post, mentioned this too. Let's see where I can find that, because it's very interesting that...
It keeps happening over and over again, you know. And I think Baron really had some insight. He's got a book called Collision of Power. And he said in this book that by the fall of 2018, the percentage of our digital subscribers who considered themselves somewhat or very conservative was in the single digits, with slightly more than 80% very or somewhat liberal. Huh. Now, Barron, like the New York Times and frankly, most of, you know, the big, you know, major big market journalism, think it is their job to serve everybody exactly the same. That's both-siderism.
Well, when you have, again, two sides, one side that is actually in some sort of a reality-based world, things that are actually happening, they respond to. They read things. They critically evaluate different things. They try to come to an opinion. They try to navigate situations as horrific as the situation in Gaza and try to make sense of it, but they do the process based on an input of accurate information. And then there's the 80% who are watching Fox News or listening to Donald Trump straight up or consuming the Daily Wire and media that's basically literally unashamedly making stuff up. There is no junction box that can.
Well, I understand, but you know the point is, though, as you know, as Barron said, 80% of the Washington Post readers he found in this survey are somewhat or very liberal. Now, cut to an industry conference, a journalism industry conference, about a week ago, and the New York Times executive editor Joe Kahn, he was giving a little talk to that conference, and he said something quite telling. This is a quote of Kahn by somebody who was in attendance. According to this person, Kahn said, "Our commitment to independent journalism is a commitment to make many of our readers unhappy most of the time."
Right. So, you know, the idea is that if we can't actually process the news accurately, we can't, even if the facts are overwhelmingly on the side of, oh, let's just say, quote, liberals or et cetera, because, again, you're dealing with a fact-based system, we're still going to report the other side, even though they're making stuff up, with equal weight and balance because we sort of have to do it. Plus, we want to keep that demographic split. We can't give people – it isn't what people want. It's what people need, right?
Right. And, you know, we don't need the media to join the Biden campaign. That's not what we're saying here. I think that's not the argument that people are making.
Why is this bad for Joe Biden?
Yeah, right. I mean, basically just make it clear that – you know, we're aware of a threat to democracy. It's going to be on the ballot. And, you know, journalism should stand for democratic principles. And their news coverage should reflect that consistently. You know, don't give that kind of voice to somebody who wants to basically take you out back and shoot you.
Well, let's take a musical break here. You know, Frank Sinatra. You know, when you want a good political song that fits perfectly in the moment, you think of Frank Sinatra back in the reprise years in the late 1960s. So here's Frank Sinatra. Song title says it all. "You're a Lucky Fellow, Mr. Smith."
"Now, Senior Mr. Smith, or whatever your name may be, you seem like a pretty nice guy, so I'd like you to listen to me. I don't want to butt into your business, but I've heard you complain a lot about all the bad luck you have and the good luck that others have got. I'd say you're a little mistaken. You've got plenty of luck, my friend. I think you should open your eyes and discover
free.
You're a lucky fella, Mr. Smith.
Mr. Smith.
To be able to live as you do. And to have that swell Miss Liberty gal carrying the torch for you.
You're a lucky fella, Mr. Smith.
Look around you if you want a prize. You should thank your lucky stars, and I mean, thank all 50 in your flag.
And you've really got a family tree.
With Washington, Jefferson, Lincoln, and Lee.
You're lucky to have ancestors like that.
Don't you know you were born with a feather in your hat?
You're a very, very wealthy gent.
I don't care if you haven't a cent. You can still have things your own way on each election day. If some poor suckers could choose, they'd like to be in your shoes. That proves that your good fortune's no myth. You're a lucky fella, Mr. Smith. You are a lucky fella, Mr. Smith.
Mr. Smith.
To be able to swing like you do. And to have that swell Miss Liberty gal carrying the torch for you.
You're a lucky fella, Mr. Smith.
Look around you if you'd like to brag. You should thank your lucky stars, and I mean, there are 50 in your flag.
Boy, you're rolling in a lot of wealth.
Your speech is free, yes siree, you've got your health.
Sure, we got our health, and tell me why not.
Take a look at the great constitution that we've got.
You're a very, very wealthy gent.
I don't care if you haven't a cent. You can still have things your own way on each election day. You're blushing red, white, and blue, but buddy, that's all right too,
because those colors look good on you.
You're a fortunate fellow.
Yes, a fortunate fellow.
And a privileged person.
Such a privileged person.
You're a lot.
Ring-a-ding-ding, right? So, well, Bob Costas talking about media. I don't know where a good time for this, but Costas was asked about the Mango Mussolini, and let's just say no punches were pulled.
He is by far the most disgraceful figure in modern presidential history. He's only become more disgraceful since 2016 and since 2020. He is a bubbling cauldron of loathsome traits, and it's only those who are actually suffering from Trump derangement syndrome, which is the way they and Fox News and all the rest of MAGA media try to brush aside all the legitimate criticisms of Trump. You have to be in the throes of some sort of toxic delusion and in a toxic cult to believe that Donald Trump has ever been in any sense emotionally, psychologically, intellectually, or ethically fit to be president of the United States. But his supporters are locked in on that.
A lot of heavy lifting in the local neighborhood thesaurus there.
Yeah, well, Bob Costas, ladies and gentlemen. Well, we'll quickly kind of wrap it up. We talked about Frank Sinatra's talking about elections. Well, just last week, the Trump campaign is ramping down a lot of the traditional things that people do when they want to be elected president, a lot of the ground activities, et cetera. It's almost like they don't really care about the election because they have a plan to win it anyway, and they're not going to accept any of the results anyway.
Like
they're sort of throwing in the towel saying, well, we're not going to win by conventional weapons. So we're just going to take it.
Yeah.
And as the trials have gone, you know, we've managed to get through an entire hour of What a Week on KSQD Santa Cruz, KSQT Prunedale with Erik Nelson.
And Tony Russomanno.
How about that? We slipped that ID right in there.
Very quickly, too.
Watching, the thing that I'm watching and the thing I'm waiting for is if they put him in Rikers for a night or something happens, to become Donald Trump, to become that kind of bloated, the hair, the bronzer, that takes 2 hours of heavy makeup lifting. This guy's got to be assembled every morning. There's a reason why when he's in the White House, executive time is what they called. He didn't even go downstairs until 11 or 12.
Sure. Yeah.
And what's happening is not only is he getting up early, he has to be put together and made up and bronzed and packaged and corseted and stuffed in his suit and his tie adjusted. If he's in the slammer, no one's going to do that for him. And what I'm hoping happens is just if they can just get pictures of him au naturel, the real Trump, what he actually looks like. We already know what he sounds like. We already know the dementia and the, you know, the disconnected sentences and the repulsive everything. But he still manages to put himself together vaguely, you know, vaguely. But a night in the Hoosegow, just one night and cameras as he's coming out. I don't even need the orange jumpsuit. I just want to see what the hair looks like.
I don't think even he'll do a night. No, I think the judge will probably put him in for a couple of hours just to give him a taste of it, at least initially.
Well, if it happens, and that's a big if, but we shall see. But, they talk about this is diagnostic criteria of narcissistic personality disorder. Let's just go through it. Just the first line of the top, the first line, Tony.
Yeah. So a person with this narcissistic personality disorder has a grandiose sense of self-importance.
Is preoccupied with fantasies of unlimited success, power, brilliance, and ideal love. Looking at you, Stormy.
Yeah, believes that he's special and unique, can only be understood by or should associate with other special people.
Requires excessive admiration.
He has a sense of entitlement.
Is interpersonally exploitative.
Lacks empathy.
Is often envious of others or believes that others are envious of him or her.
Shows arrogant behavior.
And haughty behaviors or attitudes. I don't know who that sounds like particularly.
But, one guess.
But all these colliding pathologies are what we should all be watching. And I guess the question is, does this race to the bottom as the guy slowly disintegrates and occupies? So even the New York Times has to notice.
Well, you see, there's variations of narcissism. Also, this guy isn't just a narcissist. He's a narcissistic mortification patient. That's when a narcissist like Trump crosses over to a place where he sees visions of his own demise. That's what's keeping him awake now.
And that accounts for the all caps, the constant all caps on Truth Social, which is just obsessively spiraling around. So whatever happened with Stormy Daniels and is about to happen with Michael Cohen, and we'll be back next week with the blow-by-blows of that. Though I have to say, for true repulsiveness, I think the highlight of the whole Stormy Daniels week for me was when she testified that as Trump was waddling around in his underwear, he complimented Stormy Daniels by saying, "You look just like my daughter."
Wretch.
Yeah, the ick factor is off the tables. And all you have to do is just Google, folks, Donald Trump, daughter's name and inappropriate. Just Google those three words and look at the pictures and the pathology there, because, you know, that is pretty, pretty disturbing. We usually like to go out on a funny animal story, but in the weird way, Donald Trump is our funny animal story of the day.
Not funny, ha-ha. Funny, sad.
Funny, sad.
Funny, weird.
Well, it is just about time for our boot heels to be wandering on What a Week. I will do now what they call a formal station ID. This is KSQD Santa Cruz, KSQT Prunedale. That's where it 89.5, 89.7, 90.7, and KSQD.org, Sold American.
And once again, we can say, if it's Saturday, it's been What a Week.